A very good afternoon, everyone. I myself, CA Navjot Singh, presenting you today's session on behalf of textile business advisors. And today's session is quite important and relevant for the exporter community and all the consultants who are handling their clients who are basically exporters. Now, today's session, which is quite centric to the most anticipated scheme, which we are waiting from last year, January, and which came into force from this year, January, a remission of duties and taxes on exported products, RoDTEP, if we talk about the short form, and I'll be referring that short form only. Now, in today's session, we'll be understanding about the background of the scheme procedure, which is involved in this, ineligible supplies, which are given in the notification issued in this respect, and the way forward. Now, if we talk about all these schemes which are given on exports, basically it is India cannot isolate itself with the, I would say, in isolation, that we cannot function in isolation, because India must be exporting something and it must be importing something, and all the correlation or collaboration with other countries is very important. So that's why there was a quote by Kofi Annan, who was the Secretary General of the United Nations, which said that it has been said that arguing against globalization is like arguing against the law of gravity. Now, why I'm saying that? Because the background in respect with the scheme is quite, I would say, litigative, and still the litigation is pending. If we see the current perspective of India as economy, so you will find that we are working towards a goal of 400 billion exports in this year. That was said by Prime Minister Narendra Modi that we'll be doing that. Now, at this present time, this particular scheme will help us in doing that or not, that is still a question, because after concluding today's session, we will be left with few questions which are not being answered by the, I would say, Department of Commerce yet. And obviously, after a certain point in time, we look forward to that all the queries and all the clarifications which are needed in today's time will be given by the Department of Commerce. After that, if we see from past 2 years, we are waiting for few schemes, few export-related schemes such as EOU or SEC, which completely need a overhauling, because both the schemes are quite old. And in today's time, most of the benefits which are given through Income Tax Act or maybe some other acts are not being available. So obviously we need some overhaulment. And apart from that, all these schemes of, be it like EPCG or other BFIA scheme, all these schemes would challenge altogether by USTR before WTO, that export incentives must not be given by India in such form, as it violates some of the SCM norms by WTO. Now, recently, if you were reading about that, India have opted out of RCEP as well, since India was of the view that, you know, all the concerns related to exports are not being addressed by the association. Now, after that, opted out from such a, I would say, renowned association. Now, India is still looking to reignite, you know, free trade pact negotiations. You see, there are some free trade agreements, negotiations are in with US, EU and UK as well. Our terms with US somehow impacted with the erstwhile president. Now again the talks are with the new president officials. Now all this is important, because if we just talk about RoDTEP scheme, like what it is about, why it came into force, and why so much gaga over this scheme, that would not really, I would say, give the justice to the scheme, because there are few backgrounds which are needed to be understood when we talk about the scheme and when we really criticize the government for everything. At the same time, we should be seeing the intent and I would say kind of a pressure which is given by WTO is also important to understand that why the rates are very low and why there was so much of wait and why it took so much time to bring in all the rates, because India is such a country which is with a lot of populations, and a lot of populations come from a diversified fields. So few of them always criticize the government, few of them always praise the government. At the same time, we stuck with few perceptions wherein we find ourselves in a very difficult position, that because we are the problem with the us is we are black, we are not having facts, and we are not talking, we are not having a rational communications, we are not having rational discussions. That is very important. So let me start with the problem, why there is a problem with the scheme and why this scheme came into force. So if you see, when we particularly talk about export subsidies, which violates the WTO rules, and what are those WTO rules? When WTO came into existence in 1995, at that time, there was a rule, there was an agreement which was made at that time, which said that if a country is having $1,000 per capita gross national income, then it can provide and it can go on for export subsidies. Because export subsidies, nothing but it provides kind of a boost to exporter community, so that, you know, they can have some more competitive advantage among all these developed countries. So that leverage was given to these developing countries, that if the per capita income is below than 1,000 per dollar, then you can go for the export promotion schemes. Now India, at that time, back in 1995, it was having a per capita income below than $1,000. That's why it got that exemption, and, you know, it continued with the exemptions at that time, which was provided to the various stakeholders or the various exporter communities. But if we see in 2015, when it surpassed the threshold, thereby pushing it into no exemption zone, after that, India really did not bother about, withdrawing all these six schemes, incentives, or really, I would say they should have gone through some overhaulment, or maybe India would have worked on a few guidelines, changes in the guidelines, so that it can be compliant to the WTO guidelines. Now, obviously, we had more than 20 years to do that, but we did not do that. We only did that when USTR came into the picture, and when they filed a consultation charges with the WTO, then only India woke up and thought of something, bringing the RoDTEP into the picture. Now, India's stand in this respect, in this particular whole debate, is about that when it was said that when this particular rule came into the picture, 8 years of timeline was given back in 1995, that when WTO came into picture, it said that in all the countries, all the developing countries, or maybe any country who is having per capita income more than $1,000, they have 8 years to comply with the WTO norms. Now, India's stand with this particular provision is, when it crossed the threshold of $1,000 capita income 2015, that 8 years of timeline starts from then. But the stand of USTR and the recently ruling of disputed panel, the dispute agreement panel, which said that that timeline was only available from 1995 till the end of 8 years from then only, not from the year in which you surpass the threshold. So that has, you know, some interpretation issues as well in that. Now, if we see the timeline on 14 March 2018, the United States requested consultation with India concerning certain alleged export subsidy measures. So in WTO, the kind of methodology works that firstly, you file the consultations, then a panel is being formulated. And after panel is being formulated, the case goes with a disputed agreement panel that they consult the, I would say, issues with other countries which are available in the panel as well. Then they come to the conclusion. Now, after that, there is a mechanism of appeal as well in that. Now, if we see the main contentions, so the United States stated that India is violating Article 3.1A and 3.2 of the Subsidy and Countermeasurement Agreement by the WTO. Now, on 23rd of March 2018, Canada and European Union also requested to join the consultations. And if we talk about the Article 3.1 of subsidy and subsidies and counter measurements, which said that except as provided in the agreement on agriculture, the following subsidies within the meaning of Article 1 shall be prohibited. Which will be those subsidies? Subsidies contingent in law or in fact, whether solely or as one of several other conditions upon export performance, including those illustrated in Annex B. Subsidies contingent whether solely or as one of the several other conditions upon the issue, upon the use of domestic over imported goods. A member shall neither grant nor maintain subsidies referred in paragraph 1. Now, it stated very clearly that if you are giving any subsidies on the basis of export performance, which can be with conditions related to that or maybe some other conditions, you cannot do that. So that was the violation. But we'll understand India's stand as well in that. Now, if we further move to the timeline, on 17th of May 2018, United States requested the establishment of panel as at its meeting in 28th of May 2018, the DSP established the dispute resolution board, established a panel which consisted Brazil, Canada, China, Egypt, and European Union, Japan, Kazakhstan, Korea, and several other countries as well reserved their third party rights, which were the part of that panel. Now on 16th of July 2018, the United States requested the Director General to compose the panel. And on 23rd of July, the Director General composed the panel. On 3rd of December 2018, the chair of panel informed the DSP that beginning of the panel's work had been delayed as the result of lack of available resources in the secretariat. And the panel expected to issue its final report to the parties not before the second quarter of 2019. But it got delayed again and again, and on 31st October 2018, the panel report was circulated to the members. It was the report. I will provide you the link. You can have a look at a detailed, I would say, discussion on all these schemes which were part of the contentions by USTR that it violates the SCM norms. And if we see the basis of challenge, so dispute concerned the US, United States challenged of alleged export subsidies provided by India under five set of measures. First of all, their contention was related to EOU, EHTP and BTP schemes, which is kind of a area-based schemes and not area-based, but kind of a unit-based schemes. Second, it was related to EPCG, which is export promotion capital goods. It provides you the leverage of importing goods without payment, the capital goods without payment of custom duty. Then there was a problem related to the special economic zone scheme. Then a collection of duty stipulations described in these proceedings as a duty-free import for exporter schemes, DFIS, if we talk about, and the MEIS, mercantilized exports from India scheme. So all these schemes were part of that challenge which USTR made before the WTO. Now, alleged export subsidies under EOU, EHTP, or BTP schemes, EPG scheme, SEZ, and DFIS consist of exemptions and deductions from custom duties and other taxes. And the alleged export subsidies under MEIS consist of government-issued notes, scrips, that can be used to pay for certain liabilities, the government, and are freely transferable. So there are kind of a problem, or I would say differentiation between four schemes and one scheme, because SEZ, EOU, all these are related or maybe focused towards giving the exemption related to import duty. And that is also, there are some export related foundations on them as well, that they need to perform certain kind of export obligations in response to that. And MEIS scheme, which is related to export subsidies, and in which what government does is they issue us the scripts, which we can use for payment of custom duty later on. We can transfer it as well. We can sell that document as well. So you see that problem, the main problem was with the MEIS scheme. So that somehow kind of provide extra leverage to the exporter, which is based out in India, and he's being given some extra benefit on exporting such goods. So that somehow disturbs the competitive advantage for the importer sitting in other country other than the India. Now, India argued before the panel that special and differential treatment provisions of Article 27 of the Agreement on Subsidies and Countervailing Measures still excluded it from the application of the prohibition on the export subsidies. So whatsoever provided in Article 27 related to developing countries, that few conditions are being given there, and that contention of calculation of ATL from the 2015 was also put forward before the panel. However, the parties did not dispute that India had graduated from the special and differential treatment provision that it originally fell under Article 27.2A and Annexer 6P, and the panel found that no further transition period under Article 27.2B is available to India after graduation. So that contention of ATL calculation was not taken into consideration by the panel. If we see the Article 27, therefore no longer excludes India from the application of prohibition. And India is also violating the Article 3 and 4 of FSCM agreement respectively. So that's how the case was ruled out, and the panel recommended that prohibited subsidies like DFIS to be removed or to be withdrawn within 90 days from the adoption of the report. And all these subsidies related to EOU, EHDP, BTP schemes or EPCG and MEIS to be withdrawn within 120 days. And all the subsidies which are given under the SEZ scheme to be withdrawn within 180 days from the adoption of report. Now there are two, and if we talk about the practical aspects, so after getting that report from WTO of the panel report, country have two options. Either it can go for appeal for before the appellate body, and then you have to inform the DSP as well. So on 19th of November 2019, India notified that DSP that they are going for appeal against the law and legal interpretations by the which were provided in the panel report, and since then it's pending. Now this discussion might not be relevant to, I would say, much of people, but this is important to gather the facts. I would say if you will read that report of the panel report which was circulated against which India has filed the appeal, you might not be agree with the contentions or the interpretations, but you will learn that how other countries are reading those SCM agreements or those subsidies and all these things. Because if we talk about developed countries, they do not provide that much of subsidies, export subsidies to their exporters. But India being kind of a mixed economy, that some of the part of India is capitalist, some of is socialist, and some is still economist, you know, it's a mix of everything. And after that, poor federal structure as well, that's due to some political reasons also. The red tapeism is there, and all schemes are being formulated to, I would say, appraise the exporters community, sometimes just near to the elections. So that's how India is being different from other countries. But at the same time, you will learn that why this particular scheme or why this particular subsidies, this particular RoDTEP and MEIS is being differentiated from that point of time. Because be it from the rate perspective or be it from other perspective, if we really read those articles which were given under as the reference in panel report, so you will find out that why the scheme is being differentiated now. Now, what is the purpose of RoDTEP? Now, you must be known to the purpose of MEIS, that why MEIS was given. But if we talk about RoDTEP, so if we say or talk about the general intent of government, which says that not exporting the taxes, that India cannot export the taxes, that whatever is going out of India, this will not be containing the tax portion. Now, when we talk about tax, it really doesn't mean only the indirect tax, but the direct tax or maybe mandi tax, stamp duty, various sort of taxes are being imposed in India. So those elements somehow get exported as well. So that's really not the intent of any of the Indian government, any of the present or past Indian government. Now, exporter incur various costs in if you talk about manufacturing export products, while some costs like GST and custom duties on imported raw material are either exempted or refunded. Now there are other costs as well, as mentioned above, that are still being borne by the exporters. Now there might be some hidden costs as well in this. Now what are those? State VAT and excise duty on fuel used in transportation, which is not being refunded through any duty drawback scheme or I would say any of the just one second So what are those hidden costs, be it like state VAT and excise duty on fuel used in transportation, manufacture of products, captive consumption, electricity duty, which is paid on electricity used in manufacture of goods, embedded GST in procurement from various small and composite suppliers, embedded GST and GST compensation says on coal used in production of electricity, some of the big organizations or big exporters do that. Embedded GST paid on inputs used in production of agriculture products, that is also included in that. Mandi tax paid in relation to agriculture products. Stamp duty paid on export documents. Now, all these hidden costs are not really being refunded to exporter. And if we talk about the drawback scheme, which really give you the drawback of the custom duties, you know, the duties which you pay on the imports. So, but all these duties are not really being refunded to the exporter. So that's why there is a need of kind of a reimbursement scheme, which gives you the refund of all these, all the taxes. Now, that particular scheme cannot come into picture like you, you know, file the claim of all these exporters, but rather than that, the government came up with an idea that we should formulate a rate. If we talk about a particular industry, if we talk about like textile industry or maybe plastic industry or any agriculture industry, in that you formulate kind of expenditure which that industry does on a normal basis, in a normal circumstances. On the basis of that, a rate was being formulated. If you talk about MEA scheme, the rates were like ranging between 2 to 7%. But in RoDTEP, the rates have been decreased. That may be due to some WTO pressure as well. But somehow that rates are being formulated on the basis of a cumulative, I would say, calculation. The rate cannot be different for every exporter, but it will be same for every exporter dealing in the same unit. So that's how the rates are being formulated. Now, to avoid, I would say, and making the Indian exports more competitive, the scheme was really needed. And that's why if we see the roadmap of RoDTEP scheme, that announcement which was made on for the scheme last year in January 2020, and there was a press conference in September in earlier year. And then cabinet gave its approval in March. And then there was a formation of RoDTEP committee as well on 30th of July last year. And three-member committee was formed, and which sought information from industry and all these export promotion councils that what should be rate and how that rate should be calculated. And that RoDTEP committee wrote a letter to various communities, and there were three performers, R1, R2, R3. If you will read that notification, you will see that what sort of information was sought from various, trade houses. And then implementation of RoDTEP was made available online on 1st of January 2021. And if there was an advisory, there was an advisory also issued on the very same day, stating out the procedure that how you will claim this, this particular benefit which is given by the RoDTEP scheme. Now, that procedure, the difference between procedure to claim RoDTEP and MEA is slightly different, that everything is, made online, and certain procedures have also been removed now in this particular scheme. Now, after that, Commerce Secretary said that, there are teething troubles hold up exporter tax benefits under RoDTEP schemes, because in April, if we talk about, the USTR again raised a question on the new RoDTEP scheme as well, that why are you giving export incentives to the exporter community? So that delayed response of WTO's appellate body on the earlier judgment is quite troubling the India, because still we do not know that this particular scheme is compliant with WTO or not. After that, on March, it was said that their unfinished work of finalizing tax refunds rate under RoDTEP scheme has derailed the government's plan to unveil a new foreign trade policy, because at that time there was a anticipation that new policy will come into the picture, but and some other pending, I would say, was related to other schemes were also pending at that time. So that's why they kind of delayed it. And from then only we are, you know, reading these news that rate would come in 2 weeks, 1 week. So we are hearing that only. So finally, government came up with a notification giving out the detailed guidelines by notification 19 and 17th of August, and in which they have changed the paras, like they have inserted the sub para E in para 4.01, and the they have inserted new paras ranging from 4.54 to 5.9 in particular foreign trade policy 2015-20. Now, what are the guidelines, or what are the general guidelines? I would say I'm not reading the actual language which is used in the notification, but I will be using the layman language just to make you understand that what guidelines are being given. So first and foremost important guideline is that the rebate shall not be available in respect of those duties and taxes which are exempted, remitted or credited. So all those taxes, see, the intention behind the scheme is to give the refund of only those taxes for which you are not getting the drawback or the refund through the normal tax rules or normal provisions which are given in the tax provisions. But if you somehow get the exemption or remission or that particular duty is being credited in your account, so for that, you will not get the benefit. After that, the ceiling rates under the scheme will be done by the committee in the Department of Revenue Drawback Division with the suitable representation of the DOC, DGFT, Department of Commerce, and there is a Director General of Foreign Trade, all these departments, and there will be a committee which will formulated by the Department of Revenue, which is under the Department of Ministry of Finance, and the Drawback Division is there. So this committee will make a suitable representation that how the rates will be calculated and formulated. Now, as the scheme is limited by the budget will be finalized by the Ministry of Finance in consultation with the DOC. So there is a Department of PMS, PFMS, who basically sees the all the budgeted requirement, and there is another department of IFD, Integrated Finance Division of Ministry of Finance, which sees that how much budget is being used by all these departments. So that finalization of budget will be done by the Ministry of Finance, but obviously since the scheme is under the Department of Commerce, so the consultation will be made with the DOC as well. Now, if we talk about the rebate, it is connected with the receipt of sale proceeds as well, just like GST refund, that provisions of Foreign Exchange Management Act 1999, which talks about the realization of export proceeds. Now, if you are failing to do that, so rebate shall be deemed never to be have been allowed, and you need to pay back that amount which is being refunded to you in any form. Now, it is very important to note, which I saw a difference from a swell scheme, that adequate safeguards are being provided to, you know, avoid any misuse on account of non-realization and other systematic improvement, as in operation under drawback scheme, IGST and other SGST, CGST refund related to export would also be applicable for claims made under the RoDTEP scheme. Now, in today's time, everything is being integrated. When we refer the word electronic duty ledger in respect of Customs Act, so that word is not really related to the electronic duty ledger, which is in the GST law. So both the ledgers are different, because in customs, this amendment came in but last year itself, in Finance Act 20 itself, when the new section 51B came into picture, which stated that, you know, a formulation of electronic duty ledger, which is to be managed by ICGATE, will be there to pay out any duties given in Customs Tariff Act 1975. Now, all these ledgers and all these, I would say, IT infrastructure is kind of integrated in today's time. If you see, if a absconder or there is a fraud person in GST, so is IEC also put in a red category? So, you know, everything is integrated. So you cannot save yourself, or I would say advantage yourself, by getting all these drawbacks and new schemes, because that risk assessment system is being formulated very strongly, and the government is working very extensively on that. Now, if we talk about the ineligible category or ineligible items that the scheme is not applicable or not, we will not be available to them. And if we talk about export of imported goods covered under paragraph 2.46 of FTP, which is export of repaired goods, like goods came into India for the sort of repairment, and you do the repair goods and you export it. So for those, this particular scheme will not be available. Then export through transshipment, meaning thereby exports that are originating in third country, but only transshipped through India. So they are coming into India only for transshipment purpose. Then also this scheme will not be available. Then export products that are subject to minimum export price or export duty. Now there are some conditions to certain products on which minimum export price is being decided by the custom tariff act. So in that case also this scheme will not be available. Then products that are restricted for export under Schedule 2, if certain products are restricted or prohibited, both are not eligible under this scheme. Then deemed exports, if you are doing the deemed exports as per the foreign trade policy and section 147 of GST. So just don't confuse yourself between both the provisions, because the deemed exports in GST is slightly different from the deemed exports provisions which are given in FTP. So you must be aware of both the provisions. I'm not saying that both are entirely different, but this particular term is being used in reference to the foreign trade policy, which is given in the separate chapter. Now then there is a supplies of foreign supplies of products manufactured by DTA units to SEZ. If the DTA unit is supplying something to SEZ or FTWZ, free trade warehouse zones units, then also this particular benefit will not be available, though it is termed as zero rated supply in GST, if we talk about GST perspective. And from the, as if because SEZ, as per the SEZ Act, that it is considered to be a area which is not a part of country, but you know there are certain judgments which of customs which say that export is considered only when it crosses the territorial waters of the India. So that's how it is. So that particular supply is also not being covered in this. Then products manufactured in EHTP and BTP, all these electronic hardware trademarks and biotechnology trademarks, any products are being manufactured in all these parks are also not being denied this benefit. Then there is a slightly surprising element in this. If you have heard of mover scheme, which is, I would say, the highly publicized scheme by the government of India, and which gives you a alternative schemes to the EOU structure, that EOU or maybe SEZ structure, that you can form a bonded warehouse, you can import duty-free goods, and you can pay the duty on a deferment basis if you are not exporting the product, and if you really export the product, then duty is being deferred. Now, such scheme is quite a lucrative scheme, and many of the exporter community have opted this scheme. Now, then again, it was kind of a surprising to see that why the scheme is being set out from this particular incentive. Then advance authorization, if an exporter is an advance authorization holder and he's exporting against fulfillment of export obligation, he's also out of this particular scheme. Duty-free, DFIA, special advance authorization, under a duty exemption scheme of relevant foreign trade policy, all these people are out of the ambit of this particular benefit. Then products manufactured or exported by unit licensed as 100% export-oriented unit. Then if it is manufactured and exported by any of the unit situated in free trade zones or export processing zones or SEZ zone, basically special economic zones. So these three categories, if we talk about advance authorization, then if we talk about export-oriented unit and the special economic zone, in respect of these three ineligible categories, it is being said in these guidelines, in these paras, that this will be decided by the RoDTEP committee in future, that this benefit is to be given to these authorizations, or I would say to these entities or not. Now, if we talk about the EPC committee, which kind of export promotion committee for SEZ and UUs, which represented its submission in they are kind of submitting their representations from time to time. And earlier in if we talk about after January, also they said that, you know, SEZ units should be claiming this benefit in while filing the shipping bills, but somehow it is being excluded in the final guidelines. So it will be very interesting to see that when all these units are being covered in this particular scheme. Now further, there are three more categories. If we talk about products manufactured or exported availing the benefit of notification 32.19.7, which is kind of a jobbing only, that when any imports are there only to perform certain tasks in India, basically for a job work, and then it get exported after that. So custom duty is being exempted through this notification. So that if you are doing this kind of manufacturing export assignment, then also it is not available. Then exports for which electronic documentation in IceGate EDI has not been generated, or maybe exports from non-EDI ports, then also it is not available, which is quite surprising to see, because our erstwhile in scheme there was no such restrictions for MEIS. Then goods that have been taken into use after manufacture, if you have used those goods after the manufacturing and then you are exporting it, then also it get ineligible. Then if we talk about the mechanism is related to that script mechanism only, the MEIS scripts we used to see, and it just gets transferred. But in RoDTEP, everything has been being digitalized, because earlier we used to get ourselves registered those MEIS scripts with the port on which we have exported. So that particular condition have been removed now. Now to avail the scheme, exporter shall make a claim for RoDTEP and shipping bills. Now, as I said that IceGate came up with an advisory that how you will be claiming this RoDTEP in the shipping bill. So that particular claim will be made in the shipping bill itself, firstly. Then once export journal manifest is being filed, claim will be processed by the customs. So after you will file the EGM for getting the LEO, then the claim will be processed by the customs. Once processed, a scroll with all individual shipping bills for admissible amount would be generated and made available in the user account at IceGate. You will have to maintain an account on IceGate, on which also there will be a separate credit ledger account will be there under credit ledger tab. If you have ever operated the IceGate, so you can use it practically. This can be done by IEC who have registered on IceGate with DSC, who have taken the simplified registration on that and converted the simplified registration to normal registration. Then exporter can log in into his account and generate script after selecting the relevant shipping bills. Now, this procedure will be followed. This is a kind of a mechanism which is given. Now, as I stated that duty credit ledger, if we talk about, this is particularly given in section 51B, which was proposed by the Custom Act in Budget 2020. Now, as per section 51B2, if we see the language that duties which are given in Custom Tariff Act will be paid through this ledger. Now, you cannot pay any duty apart from custom duty, such as IGST, if we talk particularly. So IGST cannot be paid through this particular ledger. Only custom duty can be paid. Because there is still now, you can understand that IGST levy is not as per Customs Act. IGST levy is as per IGST Act only. It is only collected and regulated as per the custom tariff act. Now, necessary rules and procedures regarding grant of RoDTEP claim under the scheme and implementation issues would be notified by the CBIC. Department of Revenue on an IT-enabled platform to end digitalization. Then necessary provisions for recovery of rebate amount where the foreign exchange is not realized, suspension withholding of RoDTEP in case of frauds and misuse, as well as the imposition of penalty, will also be built suitably by the CBIC. As I said, that they're working extensively on the risk assessment part. Now, what are the points to be noted? As you must have seen that, you know, this is kind of a budgeted scheme. So 19,400 crore of budget is being allocated for two schemes, RoDTEP and RoSCTL. RoSCTL is for exporting garments outside India. Now, RoDTEP scheme, which is available from 1st of January, so the budget is kind of allocated on a pro rata basis from Jan to March 21, and then March April 21 till now is being given in this budget. And since then, the exporters are filing shipping bills with necessary disclosures for claiming the incentives. Now, those who are filing continuously, now still they have not issued the revised guidelines that now what should be done and how this is to be going to be there, because certain functions which are not available till now on iSCAID. Now, if we talk about the scheme, it contains more than 8,555 products, which is moreover like around 75% of the tariff items which are given in the tariff act. And if we talk about the incentive, which it is ranging between 0.3 to 4.3, which is way much lower, or I would say half what we used to get in MEIS. And the list includes some more 1,000 products than MEIS. Now, that's the good thing that some more products are being also included in this. Now, if we talk about tobacco products, mineral products, chemicals, pharmaceutical, fertilizers, wood pulp, fibrous material, apparel, and made up textile articles, iron, steel, and article thereof, all these are being excluded from this scheme. And maybe because, you know, government think that all these sectors are doing well and do not need to be reimbursed, though various export councils after these exclusions have come into picture, and they are, you know, continuously following up with the Ministry of Finance on giving out the reason that why this particular exporters are being excluded. Now, this is a image created by Economic Times, which stated that, you know, steel, chemical, pharma industries are kept out of the remission scheme, and they are going to have a meeting with Piyush Goyal regarding this particular issue. And because pharma sector was seeking the duty of 5.6% remission, it was seeking, and chemical industry was also thinking of 2.3 to 2.9, and both have been kept out, and which plays a significant role in exports and, you know, kind of a part, important part in performing that 400 billion exports. So that's how it becomes important. Now, if we summarize the major concerns of particular the scheme, which we can say that there are lower rates, which is, in my view, is of course due to this particular WTO disputes. The government did not want to disturb WTO again now with this again this particular scheme. Then there are deprived large sector. Even if they wanted to give the benefit, I don't know why they have excluded advanced registration, EOU, and SEZ out of this. And apart from that, there are a few sectors which I just mentioned, such as steel, pharma, chemical, few of the chemical categories are also not there. So I don't know why that is being given, because it sends out kind of a negative sentiment among the exporters that, you know, the government is not helping out these particular exporters, because since the COVID was there, so these sectors have also suffered a lot. Now, in respect of judgments, if you talk about in MEIS, because since MEIS was also processed through EDI system of iSCAID, of the customs, EDI system of customs, and there were some errors. Sometimes you used to file wrong information, or I would say so due to some clerical information, you couldn't submit that, you know, you are exporting the product with MEIS benefit. So can then also you can avail the benefit through amending your shipping bill or something like that. So there are some favorable judgments. So in simple language, I would say if you have made some errors inadvertently in your shipping bill, and on a later on, if you were eligible for that particular incentive, so court have allowed that liberty to them that, you know, they are, if they are eligible for the benefit, and just because there are some errors. So that's how it's being given. And then at last, I would conclude it with my remarks that if we talk about the budget allocation, that is also interesting to see that, because in financial year 2020, The budget for MEIS was around 39,000 crore, and now it is just like one third of the particular scheme. Then reimbursement scheme also, if we see that it comes up very with a very low rates, and then with a maximum cap is also being given per unit wise per UQC. If we talk about the custom perspective, then items such as gem and jewelry would have a refund rate of 0.10%, and then whereas items such as short fabric are at 4.3%, and sectors such as steel, pharma, chemical kept out of the RoDTEP scheme, and the reason has not been given it, that government is thinking that they will never give it, or they are currently reviewing it. They have not given any reason for that. Then we are also awaiting on the decisions on account of advanced tradition use and the SEZs, that when these categories will be included. And these schemes have existed for quite some time as export enablers, and their exclusion from RoDTEP benefits could rob them for some popularity, considering there was no exclusion under the earlier MEIS schemes. That is also, I would say, valid argument that, you know, earlier than when there was no exclusion for such categories, so why there is exclusion now? And looking at the rate of incentives and intents of the scheme, which provides zero rebating of exports, are WTO compatible and thus will continue for a long time until all the products and services are brought within the ambit of GST and embedded incidence is completely neutralized. So what makes a scheme, I would say, compatible with the WTO? Now you would have get an idea that that particular law, which is India try to follow, that not exporting the taxes, only that, only to that extent only you can go for. But if you're giving something extra to your exporters, so that somehow loses the competitive advantage to the exporter who is sitting in another country. Now, if we talk about a way forward, that, you know, what should be done? So actually, when these schemes were there, so we were quite active in formulating and you know, presenting few of the export promotion councils by giving them assistance in filling out the details in R1, R2, R3, which was the performance given by the RoDTEP committee to various state bodies to fill out the calculations that how rate should be calculated. Now, surprisingly, the rate is not even half to that what we have submitted, but that's how the calculation was made. Now, since the scheme is applicable from 1st of January, we should also closely monitor that how this mechanism will be there, that we get that particular incentive from with effect from 1st of January. If there is an error, so you also know that there are judgments, you can go for that before court if the proper officer is not listening to you. Now, as I mentioned, that what can be done if you are not satisfied with the rate? So can we give those R1, R2, R3s again with the RoDTEP committee? That is the question. And then can the review be made before the authorities? Are, is this being legalized? That if we can submit those reviews. So if we see the para 4.54 and para 4.55A, which says that RoDTEP committee and DOC DGFT have powers to modify the rates as per the review given basically. So at that time, the review can be submitted, obviously. Now the consideration of review will be there or not, that is a question. But obviously, if you feel that the rate which is given a particular client or particular entity is not enough, so that representation can be made with the DOC and RoDTEP committee for review. So that's all from my side. If anyone is having any questions, they can ask.
Yeah, Navjot, this is Rajesh Venkatraman from Bangalore.
Hanji, Rajesh, how are you?
Yeah. Let me switch on my video. Yeah, we have not. We have been interacting on various platforms. I must tell you, you know, you have captured it so nicely. You know, thank you so much for, you know, sharing this inputs. You know, you have been doing this for quite some time now. I started noticing you from your first FTP session. You know, you conducted two sessions, FTP yes, 1 and 2, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it is brilliant, boss. You know, like I find you, you know, I interact with industry extensively. You know, I have more than 2 decades of experience. I have received an invitation from IIMB Bangalore. You see, I'm an alumnus of IIMB Bangalore. I have received an invite from them to be their guest faculty in the area of foreign trade, but I'm a part of Smith's legal team. Okay, so they are actually, you know, very conservative company, you know, like where to sneeze also I need to ask them. Okay, frankly speaking, but fact of the matter is they do, you know, really take good care of me. I have been with them for past 16 years, ever since they set up their, you know, shop in Bangalore. So that is the reason I told you, you know, I don't want to jump into it. And this is nicely done. You know, I am, I started following up, you know, following you in various other, you know, your articles and so on, and very promising, Navjot, you know, like you are doing a lot of hard work. I must appreciate.
Thank you so much.
And I'm